and new hardware that the Axis forces squared up to the Allied Tunisia offensive, an operation that was about to begin in early November 1942. On the evening of November the 7th, 1942, the Allies stood on the verge of launching the biggest amphibious landing in history. Off the coast of Morocco, the Western Task Force had sailed from the American East Coast and taken up position for an assault on Casablanca. In the Mediterranean, troops of the Central and Eastern Task Forces made ready for attacks on the ports of Iran and Algiers. At his Gibraltar headquarters, Eisenhower knew that his preparations were complete. The time for battle had arrived. Operation Torch would be just the first stage in the hard task of clearing the Axis forces from North Africa. The Allied commander could be confident in the men and materials under his command, but in war, there are always uncertainties. Eisenhower could not be sure how the local French troops would react to the invasion. He did not know how quickly the Axis would build up a presence in Tunisia. Far away in Libya, the charismatic figure of Rommel still led a substantial military force towards the border with Tunisia. There was also the reality that Operation Torch was the first time that American and British troops were joined in a single army. But Eisenhower could be sure that one way or another, a memorable campaign was about to begin. It would involve 6 months of fighting on the battlefield of Tunisia. On November the 4th, 1942, the armoured divisions of the British 8th Army smashed their way through the line of the German Panzerarmee Afrika. In the deserts of Egypt, one of the most decisive engagements of the Second World War was at an end. The triumph of the 8th Army at the Battle of El Alamein proved to be a turning point in the struggle to control North Africa. And for British Prime Minister Winston Churchill, it marked the end of the beginning of the Second World War. But there was still more fighting to be done on the dry lands of North Africa. In the weeks that followed El Alamein, the German Field Marshal Rommel was able to withdraw his African army as his British rival Montgomery took up the chase. In the early days of November 1942, Montgomery could be well pleased with the progress of the Desert War. As he began his westward pursuit of Rommel, the 8th Army commander knew that a massive Allied operation was about to begin on the other side of the African continent. This was the biggest amphibious landing ever undertaken. Codenamed Torch, the operation was a joint British-American enterprise under the command of General Dwight D. Eisenhower. Three huge task forces were organized to bring an entirely new Allied army to the lands of North Africa. On November the 8th, 1942, a total of 107,000 troops prepared to go ashore on the coasts of Morocco and Algeria. At the time, both countries were colonies of Vichy France. There were no Germans or Italians waiting for the Allied troops in November 1942, but there were French colonial troops loyal to the Vichy regime. The Allies could not be sure how they would react to the invasion. Eisenhower and his fellow commanders were also concerned that the full force of the Axis enemy was likely to be present before their final objective could be achieved. But it was a worthwhile and ambitious objective. The plan was to force the enemy out of North Africa for good and open the way for an attack on Sicily and Italy beyond. The concerns of the Allied commanders were well founded. Victory in North Africa would not be an easy task. For 6 long months, the Allies and the Axis joined in battle in a series of bloody engagements before the long North African War reached a final conclusion. The location was the third of the French North African possessions. It was a time that saw some of the most gripping confrontations of the Second World War. This was the battlefield of Tunisia. In July 1942, the political leaders in Washington and London made the decision to open a new front in the battle against Hitler and the Axis powers. At the time, Allied resources were still not powerful enough to risk a full-scale assault on Northwest Europe. But there was a strong desire to bring American troops into action as quickly as possible. Anything that could draw enemy resources away from the terrible fighting in the Soviet Union would be a positive development for the Allied cause. There was also a strong desire to familiarize British and American forces with the idea of fighting alongside each other. By September, it was decided to launch a new offensive in the North African War that already had been raging for 2 long years. For the first time, the British and Americans were to join forces in a vast naval operation codenamed Torch. By the beginning of November, 3 Allied fleets were sailing towards strategic locations in the northwest of the African continent. It was a massive logistical enterprise. From the east coast of the United States, the Western Task Force sailed towards the Moroccan port of Casablanca. From ports in Scotland, the Central and Eastern Task Forces journeyed through the Straits of Gibraltar in the direction of 2 key ports in Algeria, Oran and Algiers. The Eastern Task Force was alone in containing British troops among its number. There were strong political reasons behind this decision. Morocco and Algeria were colonies administered by the rump French state based at Vichy, and the Vichy regime held a strong anti-British feeling. It had no diplomatic ties with Britain, but it did maintain contact with the United States. For this reason, Operation Torch was intended to look as much like an American enterprise as possible. But the United States was still not ready to launch an operation of the size of Torch without the assistance of the British, and the strategic prize on offer in North Africa was simply too good to ignore in late 1942. A successful landing in Morocco and Algeria could lead to the capture of Tunisia. There was now the chance to force the enemy out of North Africa for good. On the map, the Allied plan was obvious. The new Anglo-American army would sweep forward from the west, while the British-led 8th Army advanced from the east. And by the time of the Torch landings, this existing North African army was already moving forward. By early November 1942, times were changing in the Desert War. On the 4th, Montgomery sealed his great victory at El Alamein as Rommel's Panzer Army began a retreat through Libya. The next day, the Central and Eastern Task Forces passed through the Straits of Gibraltar. At the same time, the Western Task Force approached the Atlantic coast of Morocco. Operation Torch was about to begin. Allied commanders knew that the Torch landings would not be opposed by Axis forces. But as H-hour approached, they could not be sure how French colonial troops on the ground would respond. This was just one uncertainty in the minds of the Allied commanders in the early hours of the 8th of November 1942, as the biggest amphibious landing in history began. In the weeks prior to the Torch landings, the Allies made a series of secret diplomatic efforts in an attempt to make the Torch landings as smooth as possible. Their aim was to gain support for the operation amongst French commanders in North Africa and in France itself. After much debate, the French war hero General Henri Giraud was identified as the key figure to bring his countrymen over to the Allied side in North Africa. On the eve of the landings, he was secretly picked up by a British submarine off the coast of southern France. His destination was Eisenhower's headquarters inside the